Oh, folks, I want to tell you, there's coming a day, and it's right now, when we need men who are going to take a stand. We need men like Joshua who will tell his neighbors, you choose for yourself, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We're so happy to have you with us today. And if you're visiting with us, we want you to know that we are absolutely delighted to have you. And I know that God is going to bless you. And we just hope that you'll be back with us. And if you're looking for a church home, you found one. You'll never find a friendlier place where people love God and love one another than right here at Parkway Assembly. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Turn with us this morning to 2 Timothy chapter 4. We're going to read beginning in verse 6. I want to speak to you on the topic, Fathers of Faith. Fathers of Faith. Paul writing to Timothy says, for I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time has come for my departure. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. Today, more than ever, we need fathers of faith. The family is under attack as it's never been under attack before in America. There are sinister demon-influenced forces that are trying to destroy the very fabric of American society. And they're attacking the family, the Christian home, the foundation. And I want to tell you, when the home, the Christian home, is destroyed, the church will be in great jeopardy, because God has designed the Christian home as the foundation of the church and of society. And we're under attack by the most vicious forces, television, media. We've got shows that there's no longer a Leave It to Beaver. Dick Van Dyke, Andy Griffith. Now the homes are Modern Family, with all kinds of dysfunctional families, and this is being portrayed as the new normal. And what we need desperately in America, we need men of character, integrity, and honor, men who will be faithful to lead their families in righteousness, men who not only talk the talk, but they walk the walk. Men that will be bold and courageous in their stand against evil. First, we need men who will make a commitment, a firm commitment to God, to Christ, to their families, to their marriage, to their home. Men who will fight. Nehemiah said to the people, fight for your family and fight for your home. There's a call going out to today that we need to stand and fight for our homes and fight for our children and for our families. Commitment means more than I will do this until it's no longer fun. I'll do it until it gets difficult. Commitment goes beyond just a shallow, superficial desire. Many of you that grew up playing football knew that it was customary. We were talking the other day about starting. We used to start the 1st of August, and it seemed like every year it was 100 degrees. And we practiced, and we would have 100-something guys come out, and after about 2 weeks, we were down to 50. Because you know, Brother Ed, what I'm talking about. They weeded out all those who thought they wanted to play, and they got down to those who had a commitment and a desire. And you know, I think the world is weeding out men. The Bible says a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. If you put your hand to the plow and you give up, you're not worthy of the kingdom. Daniel was a young man, a teenager. Think about Daniel. He was taken from his home to a strange land, a bizarre culture, a new language. Everything is new. He is told, if you want to survive, you better go along and get along and don't make any waves. But something had been planted deep in Daniel's heart and life. Something that when they said compromise your faith and your beliefs, don't rock the boat, don't create waves. And Daniel took a firm stand and said, I will not compromise the word of God and what God has given to me, and I will hold on to that. And God honored Daniel and blessed him, and the favor of God was upon him. Isaiah 50 and verse 7, he says that his face was set like flint. What does that mean? His face is set like flint. No hesitation, no wavering, no compromise. He was determined. The psychologists tell us that we have three basic things we get from our earthly fathers. First, we get our identity. We get identity from our earthly fathers. I see kids and the shootings in the schools, the young people that are confused, and many of them are saying, who am I? Why am I here? What am I doing? What's my purpose in life? Where am I going? I don't know who I am. I want to tell you, Jesus said, when you pray, say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. We have a heavenly Father. Amen. We've got a Father in heaven who loves us. We have a Father. We can come and say, my identity is not in money or things or positions, but my identity is that I am a child of the King and I belong to God. Amen. Many of you have heard the story. I think it's been around on the internet. I've seen it a couple of times of Ben Hooper. The story is the seminary professor vacationing in Gatlinburg sees an older white-haired man visiting from table to table. He looks over there and he says, oh, I hope that guy didn't come over here. I'm trying to eat my pancakes, and I don't want him to come over here and visit. Sure enough, he walks over there to visit, and he says, who are you? What are y'all doing? And he says, well, I'm a seminary professor. I'm here with my family. He says, let me tell you a story. He said, you see that mountain over there? There was a young mother who was unmarried. She gave birth to a little boy. That little boy had the hardest time because as he would go to the store, Little League, everywhere, people were always saying, oh, hey, son, what's your name? Who's your daddy? And he said, I could never answer people. And he said, I always got where I would hide. I would try to avoid them. But he He said it seemed like every time that I'd get to school or I'd get to a little league or something, and somebody had always come and say, "Son, how are you? What's your name? Who's your daddy?" And he said, "I never had an answer." He said, "One day we had a new preacher. He said, 'Wouldn't you know it? I'm trying to get out the back door,' and the new preacher says, 'Hey, son, how are you? Who is your daddy?'" And he said, "There's an awkward silence." And everybody sort of stopped. And the preacher figured it out very quickly with the help of the Holy Spirit. And he said, "Oh, I recognize you. You're a child of God. You're a son of God, and you belong to Him, and I see Him in you this day." He said, "Son, go and claim the inheritance that God has appointed for you." The white-haired man said, "That little boy was never the same." He said, "That little boy was me, and I've never been the same since." When he walked away from the table, the seminary professor motions for the waitress and says, "Do you know who that guy is?" She said, "Yeah, everybody knows him." I said, "That's Ben Hooper, the governor of Tennessee. We all know him." But you know, our identity does not come from earthly things, but from our heavenly Father. We get our self-worth from our earthly fathers. And I want to tell you, we love you. We love you at Parkway. We love you just as you are. We love you right now. You don't have to clean up. We love you. We care about you. I want to tell you, you're an original, one of a kind. You've got a fingerprint that is unique. And God made you, and God loves you. Amen. We get security from our earthly fathers. When I was little, we were talking the other day, and I shouldn't say this because I may date myself. But when I was a little boy, we didn't have central heat and air. We had fans, and guess what we did? The windows were open with screens. And when you would lay there and you're a little boy, you hear all kinds of noises and sounds and animals squealing and just every noise in the world. And right about the time your imagination's going wild, you can yell in there, "Daddy." And he would always say, "I'm right here. It's all okay. Go back to sleep." And you know, it just took that word to give you the comfort and the security that you needed. Just that word, just that little bit was all that it would take. Secondly, we need fathers who will lead. We need fathers who will lead. You know, it's possible to be a male and not be a man. There's more to being a man than having a zipper on your pants. You know, it's possible to be married and not be a husband. Did you know that? 1/3, according to statistics, 1/3 of all children born in America today are born into homes without a father. 1/2 of all the children being raised in homes today do not have a father in their home. Time magazine in an article said physical absence of the father from the home is the most serious problem facing American society today. You see, the father's home or presence in the home will determine the child's success and happiness to a great degree. Now, I've shared statistics before. Very quickly, let me just share. 63% of the young people who commit suicide come from fatherless homes. 90% of those that run away come from fatherless homes. 85% of children with behavioral problems come from fatherless homes. 80% of rapists come from fatherless homes. I could go on, I'm not. But I want to tell you, one of the great struggles in America today is the absence of the father in the home, and America desperately needs men who will lead, who will take a stand, who will claim their families for God and say, no more, I stand for my family. Single mother, don't give up, because God is with you and God will bless you and God will honor your prayers and God will intervene on your behalf. So you stand up. But God's plan is for a mother and father to be in the home together. That's His plan. Father, you set the tone for your family. You set the direction. You're the thermostat, if you will. You determine the spiritual health of your family. Dad, you're going to give an account. You're going to give an account one day of how you led your family. I caught more from my dad than I was taught. What does that mean? It means he didn't sit down every night and say, now we're going to do a Bible study. That's not what we did. But I saw him reading his Bible. I watched him pray. I watched him lead and worship and teach Sunday school. I watched him be faithful. I watched his life, and I caught more from him than I was ever taught. And we need men who will model Christ's likeness and will lead in their families and lead in their homes and lead in the church. We need fathers to take a stand. I caught a lot from him because he modeled Christ. He modeled Christ. Why did God choose Abraham? Why did he choose Abraham? He said, I know Abraham. That's what God said. He said, I know Abraham that he would what? That he would command his family and his children in the things of God. Not that he would suggest, not that he would recommend, but he would command his children. That's why he was chosen, to impart faith into his family. I've had some say, well, Pastor, I just want to expose my children to all of the different religions and let them choose when they get of age. I'm like, if you know that there's one road that leads to eternal life and another that leads to death, why would you want them to choose? It's like saying, well, this one's got poison in it. This one's got milk. You choose which one you want. Folks, our responsibility as mothers and fathers is to train our children and to lead them and to model Christ and to model faithfulness and to model the path that they should walk so that when they are grown, they will not depart from the faith. The number one goal you've got, Dad, is to train your child in the ways of God so that they will know Him. And you need to pray with your kids. I bet I told thousands of Bible stories. I told them, and we had fun, and we laughed. And my kids didn't know the Bible because they had memorized it. They knew it because they had heard me tell Bible stories over and over and over again. And they would say, hey, Dad, tonight, tell this one. And we would tell it and we would pray at the end. You know, I believe it's our responsibility to pray over our families, pray over our children, and to cover them in the blood of the Lamb of God. You know, in Exodus, he didn't tell all the kids, now kids, go out. I want you to get a lamb and I want you to put the blood on the... No, Who was responsible for taking the blood of the lamb and putting it on the doorpost? Who was responsible for sealing that family with the blood of the lamb? It was the father of the home, and he took the blood and he covered the home and he covered the family. And we need fathers today who will plead the blood upon their families and cover their homes and say, "Oh Lord, cover us when the death angel comes. Come and pass over us and protect us this day." Amen. You might notice the pattern in Genesis. Abraham always did three things, and they were always in the same order. You'll find this all through Genesis. Whenever Abraham moved, he built an altar. Second, he pitched his tent. And third, he dug a well. Now, why would he do that every time? He would do an altar, pitch a tent, dig a well. Because the altar was the commitment to God. Pitching the tent was covering his family. And digging a well was symbolic of his vocation. In America today, we've got those all backwards. It's all about vocation first, your family second, and if there's any time left over, we give it to God. And that's why America and our society is deteriorating, because he said, put God first in your family, in your home, and then let family be next, and vocation be third. Jesus said, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be added unto you." Amen. Do you pray for your family? Have you blessed your wife and your children? Do you bless them? Do you bless them? Do you come in morning and at night and bless your family and bless them with faith and with the presence of God? Do you pray over them and intercede on their behalf? Oh, folks, I want to tell you, there's coming a day, and it's right now, when we need men who are going to take a stand. We need men like Joshua who will tell his neighbors, "You choose for yourself, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." I know you might say, "Pastor, you're getting a little old-fashioned." Let me tell you something. I don't care what others do. I had one parent say, "Well, I have the kids over to my house, and we serve them alcohol here because we want to watch and we want to know what's going on." No. One said, "Well, we instruct them on safe sex and we give them the instructions they need." No. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Amen. Folks, it's time to have some men who say, "I'm not going to let MTV raise my kids. I'm not going to let Hollywood raise my kids. I'm going to raise them according to this word and the unchanging word of God. And I'm going to rehearse it in the morning and rehearse it in the evening. And I'm going to believe God for them." We need men who will take a stand and stick it out when times are tough. Men who will not check out. We need men when somebody comes to pick up their teenage daughter. I used to give them the all-nation speech. I used to give them a little speech and tell them in the end was that, "If you harm my daughter, there won't be any nation where you'll be safe because I'll be after you." We need fathers somebody comes to date their teenage daughter, needs to sit them down and say, son, where do you go to church? Where do you go to church? And know something about them and not just let anybody come walking in the door and go out with their daughters. You say, but you can't do that today, Pastor. Yes, you can. And you can believe God. And you can follow the word of God. We need men that are going to take a stand. And lastly, we need men who will remember the importance of finishing well, finishing the course. Our society does not emphasize finishing the course any longer. We need men who are going to be just as strong with 10 minutes left in the fourth quarter as they were at the kickoff. Paul was in that Mamertine prison. He was writing to Timothy. He realized he was at the very end of his life. And he knew that probably the next morning would bring the end of his life. Paul had one opportunity to speak final words to his young friend. Did Paul say, Timothy, I've really had it rough. I can't tell you the troubles I've had. I'm in prison. Probably will be executed in the morning. Why don't you go home? No. You know what he said? He said, Timothy, I have run the race. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. And now there is a crown of righteousness waiting for me. And the righteous judge is going to give it to me in that day. Hallelujah. I want to tell you, Paul could see beyond the moment. He could see beyond this one day. He saw a picture. He saw that this life is not all there is. There's something bigger and there's something better. I want to tell you, God will be with you, Father, when the going is tough. Mother, when the going is tough, if you will call upon Him, He will never leave you. He'll never forsake you. He will carry you home and He'll be everything that you need. He said, I will be a father to the fatherless. I will be there when they need me. And I want to tell you, God loves you and He's for you and He has plans for you and He wants to bless you and He wants to give you hope and a future, and He wants to bless your end more than your beginning.